Welcome to the lecture number 31 of the Deep Learning course. And in this session, we are going to talk about a very interesting topic that is called the autoencoder. So why this topic is very interesting, you will be seeing very soon that there are some very different kind of notions that are associated with this kind of architectures. And the idea is this, that here I am going to develop a neural network that is trained to copy output. So very weird kind of thing. Means what we want, that there is some neural network. Let's not bother about that, what is inside, what is the architecture. Right now, only understand this part, that whatever I'm going to provide as an input, the same thing should come as an output. Okay, this is a special kind of network. We are not sure that how much we will be able to do that, because if something has been fed, the same thing I want to take the output, whether I would be able to provide this. Sir, what is the use of this thing? Because if you want the same thing, because this item is anyway available with you, let me call it X, let me call it X hat. So if X is available, what is the need? Okay, very weird kind of concept. That's why we are going to use it. So before answering this question, let me answer this question, that this kind of circuit, making this kind of circuit is not easy. So that's why it is written that I'm not sure that how successful we would be to make. It is not easy. What do you think? You may be thinking, sir, it is not a difficult task, because because if there is an input, let us just talk about the input. So this input, there are some system, and how many neurons I need here? Same number of neurons, same number of neurons, same number of neurons, same number of neurons, same number of things, same number of output, because I want the output to be same. So everything that feeds over here should transfer here and go from here to here, and immediately we will be able to find out this. This is the most simple. Okay, so why you are telling that, sir? Why you are telling that it is not possible, it is difficult? The ResNet architecture, what was there? In the ResNet also, there were a lot of circuit, lot of layers were there. And we were thinking that if this much is actually sufficient, then all these things are going to copy as a one. We have seen there also that it was not possible. Copying the same thing into the next layer is not possible. Why? Because the possibilities are enormous. Na? The weight could be anything. Just for the sake of just clarity, let me tell you that weight could be from 0 to 1, any fractional number, any number. So out of them, one is going to be only one value, and therefore probability of hitting on that particular value is actually zero. And if you want to go, for example, if you want to reduce something, you have to find out the gradient and going towards that thing, that may not be available. Here it was not available. All possibilities where the lot of weights are everywhere there. The thing that you want is only a single answer. And that's why it is very difficult to come up with that answer. It's not that easy. Okay, it's not that trivial. Okay, it is not that trivial. All right. So what we think, that if something is there that you are going, whatever you are going to feed, it is going to take the output, take same thing as an output. So you may think that this network circuit has a representation in some way, it's a representation of this particular representation. Let me call that representation as H. Let me call it that this representation is H. Sometimes it is also called Z. That is not, let's not bother about this. So this is some representation it takes, that how the things looks like. If there is some representation, then okay, definitely there will be some part which is actually going to make that. So this part is going to make this representation, and the second part is going to work on this representation and produce the output. We can think in that way. Okay, right now I'm not going into the much detail, but this could be that if you have a circuit, you may think that if network could be an underlying method by which it find out some representation of the input, and that representation is going to be generated by something, and that then something going to use that particular part to find out the final output. We can call it encoder, that is actually layer, And then there is a decoder part that actually decodes this thing and give me the output. So this is an encoded decoded setting where then only you can give the answer, okay? Otherwise you could not. If you can build the thing such that there is some encoded decoder network, then only you would be able to produce the thing. If you follow my convention, then this part is going to produce the hidden representation. Let me call it hidden representation. So while generating this, this particular part has seen this image. He was exposed to that particular part. But the second part, for which we are actually, that is actually going to generate the final output, he have not seen the original image. Never seen the original image. He have only seen that what is the hidden representation, and based on the hidden representation, he is able to generate this particular thing. Surprising thing, eh? Because this particular part has not seen the original image, only seen the hidden representation. Using the hidden representation, he is going to build the complete data. That's an interesting idea. Okay, so this we have discussed a few minutes back, that there is a hidden representation, and that actually codes that what is a coding on whatever the things over there, and then for the input X. So encoder, however we should write E, but here it is written F. I will change here. So hidden representation is going to be a function that is going to provide an X. It is going to find, because in math these things, so there is a mathematical function F that if you provide the X, you can find out the hidden representation. So what is the task of the second part? That take this hidden representation and apply some other function, because it is a different kind of function, and give me X, maybe X estimate. Okay, so there is another function G that takes the hidden representation. So this function can be also be written as G of H of X, and this we think that should be equal to X. Okay, so our objective is in this particular kind of circuit is to make this kind of thing. Till now I am only talking that what to do, but use of this thing. Okay, very important thing is this, that if you understand this particular concept, interesting thing, because it is a hidden representation. So if we can tame it in some way, so it could be very useful for that particular task. There are different tasks that we want to do on the image. So this is the one way to find out the right kind of feature. If we can regulate this particular representation in some way, because in the network circuit there would be some representation. So we can take that particular hidden layer output, whatever the output that we have, and instead of using this image, I can use this. Because image, even if it is 100 cross 100 image, there are 10,000 values. But if here the circuit has a 500 neurons, so we can just take 500 size. So we can reduce the size. We can do multiple things over there. Very interesting idea. Really important thing into the deep learning community, okay, that we have. Okay, so a few minutes back I was talking that there is a neural network circuit, and in this circuit somewhere there is a hidden representation. But people has actually come up with this idea that can we systematically reduce the number of layers? However, it was not required. But if we can systematically reduce the number of layers, what would happen? It means that I am forcing this network, in this encoder, to learn something of this particular size only. And this can be generated to make the complete thing. It is a kind of data reduction, means dimensionality reduction. I am doing dimensionality reduction. And also I am telling that focus on those important parts which can regenerate, which can represent most of the data, most of the information of your image. Otherwise you cannot construct. How can this construct it? If this does not contain the important property of X, this X cannot be used to do that. And I am forcing that you learn lesser number of things. Very interesting idea. Finding out the feature is actually going to be lesser. Very interesting idea. Sometime, and this kind of setting where I'm telling that I'm going to reduce all level setting, it is called the under complete autoencoders. It is called the under complete autoencoders. So over complete can also be possible. Would you like to increase the things over here? What you say? Would you like to increase the number of things over here? Would you also like to do that?
So it will be basically a decoder, then encoder, something like that, or over complete.
Good idea. Good idea. I appreciate this. But will this be useful? Let me say that I am going to make this kind of circuit where I am going to increase this increase at this layer. So will it be that thing in the under complete? I am forcing that whatever input size is, if there are 10,000 bits, make it 500. Okay. If I am going to increase it, so you may think, sir, it may be again on the same logic that we have discussed. We were talking about earlier. We can think that if it is going to be a make these values as a zero, and then you put 111 everywhere means identity mapping. Let it happens that identity mapping happens. The same thing that is going to be this input image. Using same thing, you can generate the same thing once again. Here also I am telling that I am going to increase the thing. Okay. So if we increase the number of thing, is it useful or not? It is of no use. Make sense? If you decrease this size, it is very useful because it is going to force something that look for the important portion only. I cannot take the complete image. They cannot take the complete data. Come up with something that is very useful into there that essentially represent all the data, and therefore I can use this. Happy? However, it is not the case. What happens? That sometimes you know that your data is not linearly separable. For example, let me say that this is the data. These are positive points. These are the negative points. Is it a linearly separable data? No. It is a two-dimensional data where everything is given x and y. Okay. But if I say that I know that what is this position, say cx and cy, center of this particular point, is under root of x minus cx square plus y minus cy square values, and then plot all these points. What would happen? All the points which are actually at this center, they would be at the lower level. But as you go along, this value is going to be larger. So these points are going to come up. You can see that there is something this kind of structure, three-dimensional structure is going to become coming over there. Then you can safely cut using a hyperplane over there. In the lower dimension, when you project it into the right way to the higher dimensional space, the data can be linearly separable. Now maybe, I don't know, that it may be possible that you can do something and now you can reduce something to better representation, and you can do that. You can find out is the number of neurons, it actually reflects to increasing the number of dimensions, and then sometime obtained. So what I wanted to say, that if you increase the things, it may also be useful. In many cases, it may also be useful. So that's why initially increase the thing, and then after that, they decrease to the smaller number. You would see some architectures. Understand? If you have 50 values, you increase to 70, 80 values, and then you reduce to 10 values. Make sense? So this is also a good idea, okay? Sometimes you increase the thing. Some important properties. You know that you don't want to train the things in any way. You want to do some kind of regularization also. If you apply, for example, so what would happen with the dropout? You cannot use the same circuit again and again. So everywhere you cannot put the one value, because this time the value was available, next time the value is not available. So with that thing coming with earlier, even if it was possible, but when you are going to apply different kind of regularization into the circuits, then coming up those kind of identity connection is not possible. So most probably with a very high probability, you would be able to get something, you would be getting something that is going to be interesting. All right. Network is forced to prioritize with aspect of the input, which aspects of the input should be copied. Therefore, it learned the useful properties of the data. The learning process minimizes this particular loss. What is this particular loss? Once again, you know this, that I'm going to use this X and this X bar, which is actually what? It is G of F of X. So this quantity NX, I'm going to put this into the loss function, maybe some how bad this particular representation is. And then we want to minimize this. This can also be MSE, mean square loss. So then if the loss is mean square loss, then whatever the thing that you are going to learn, is it is something related to the PCA. Okay. Very important thing is this, that if encoder and decoder, if they are going to have very large power, if their power is very large, then mostly it will be possible that the system will not learn anything. So if you want to learn something interesting, they have less power. Why? Let me tell you. So let me give you an idea. So do you understand that what I told? That if these two things are going to be very powerful, then this small representation that I'm going to learn, I would not able to learn it. I may get something bad. Let me give a counter example. Let's assume that you are going to feed something, and this is a very powerful thing. And powerful thing means what? It can store everything, store every data that is going to be given to it. It can store all the things. If it can store all the things, it can also some index. Lot of data is there. For example, your index is your ID, your bits ID. Okay. If I get that ID, I can get all your information related to you. So does ID tells anything about you? Mostly not. About your property, it tells you about your branch, etc. But about your properties, it does not tell anything. So there is a representation that is your ID. Into G also, G is also very powerful. So somehow while they're learning, it transfers the data from here to here, and it also store all the data over here. Because when I'm showing this, somehow it is in a multiple iteration, it is sending the data to the second part, and the second part it is also going to create the same kind of table. Okay. Procedure is this: whenever I am going to show this, this F is just going to search into the table and tell me that what is the index. And this index is the representation of this is hidden. Index is the hidden representation. The second part is going to use that hidden representation and pick that particular thing and produces this particular thing. Is it not a perfect? Output would be generated. Whatever being input, you find out that what is the in ID is represented over here. This identity is going to be searched by the G and find out that what is the detail, and that detail is produced over here. Perfect example. So that is not our problem. Whatever, let's say I am telling that F and G are very high capacity. That I am telling, that they have very high capacity. If they have very high capacity and their capacity is very high, then it is possible. No, it is not useful at all. So why it is happening? Because these two parts are going to have are actually very much they are very strong. They can store everything. That's why you need not to have very high capacity. With the small capacity networks, you can get the better representations. Patients. Eat detail. Now I want to tell you something that is interesting. Okay. This is what the detail is. Okay. So you understood that if you want to make the autoencoders, so you are going to take some, with respect to the input, you are going to generally put the number of layers which are actually lesser, and after that you get something as a bottleneck, and this is called the bottleneck. This is the hidden representation, and after that you repeat the same thing. Whether the weights would be same or not? No, weight not be same. In weights of encoder and decoder would be and different. Decoder are going to be different. So this kind of structure people talk about, that whatever you are going to get, you are going to get X hat as an output.
Sir, you explained that increasing number of layers will increase the size of the image will be more better. So why are we using this case?
So I'm telling that it's in some cases. Okay, not in every case. That was a special kind of data where we have seen that it is important. So it may be possible for your data also, it is useful. So you can apply it, nobody is stopping you. But most of the cases, in general cases, you want to reduce it so that you can come up with some digest kind of the thing that is more useful. So you most of the time you want to reduce it.
So what is the main use of the autoencoders?
Very good question. So one thing is this, that you can find out the good representation of the input. If you can find out the good representation, then this would be more. Okay, we would come to that. For example, if you want to make a classifier, you can input this image to the classifier. Let's assume that there is a model that can do the classification. If you feed this thing and you feed this thing, what do you think? Because you know that both the representation are going to be the same for the same data, na? So those representation are same. So you can think that this feeding this thing would be an efficient way. So you can very easily make the model converge, and accuracy of your model would be high. This is the way to find out the right feature.
So what is the use? Why are we decoding it? Why aren't we stopping at edge? Why are we decoding it? Why are not we stopping at edge?
Okay, this is again a very good question. That why we are stopping after this we can stop. Okay. But we don't know that what is H, na? How can we know that H is a right representation? Because H can be anything. If you devise a circuit over here and you can get an output, so it is a good output. So what you do, you deploy another circuit that can decode and produce X dash, and you minimize the distance between them. If both the images are same, then you say that it looks like the representation is good. Otherwise, how would you know? You don't know, na? Because we have to do something to find out the good thing. This is for our convenience. Otherwise, in this way, automatically the system would learn the good representation. Na? You by yourself can think that encoder-decoder architecture means how many neurons should be there, how many layers should be there, should be based on the complexity of your data distribution. Okay, this is a very simple thing. Now, if you have any question, please ask. I'm going to discuss a very interesting thing that is going to be important. Yeah. Do you have any questions? Any question from online students? Ruchir, Apur, Pushar? No? Okay. We have understood. We are now into the understanding that given the things, I want to find out the best representation. That's why this circuit is there. Okay, now how should I say it? I am drawing the three-dimensional thing, but generally the data is very high-dimensional. Let's assume that we have image data, and it image is of 100x100. How many values we have? 10,000 values, it is very high dimensional data. Let's assume that in some sense we have reduced something, and into the reduced dimension, what do you think? The image would be everywhere in the three dimensional space where the image, all these points are going to be image. Yes or no? No. Because you know that if I image this is a smiley, okay, and if I just put into this particular way, I am going to change it. This portion I am going to put here. This portion I am going to put here. This portion I am going to put here. Is it the image? No, it is not an image. So. But everything is not inside the data. Everything is not the data. Okay. There is an attribute called is. I need to give it 500, but it would never be taking the 500 value. Minus 50. this is not a good data. This is not a data point. So data point would not be distributed everywhere. Data point would be somewhere here. Okay. Sure? Clear? Data point would be somewhere. There would be some distribution, I don't know. Would it be a Gaussian distribution? Gaussian distribution means one point and nearby things are, at one point there is a very high chance, other point they would be distributed. After 2 sigma, the data is nearly not there. Is it something like that, Scott? No. Maybe some distribution would be there, data distribution would be there. All right, very good. So if you understand this thing, then definitely you can think that if I'm going to make this particular thing, and again I'm going to make that into the hidden this. So whether the hidden representation can be anywhere, we don't know, because hidden representation can be of many time, many kind of representations, and all those representation are going to come to the same thing. Okay, there are hidden representations and there are multiple such representations. So it is possible. This time it is maybe the when this data means all the data was not given to me, was given to me, and I have, when I have find out its hidden representation, it is possible that it is going to fill the space. Make sense? You agree with me? So will this be a right thing? Yes, why? The point is this, that if it fills the space, then this point would also come somewhere. this point which was, but this also I'm going to get some representation. So this representation would be, looks like that is a genuine representation. Not a, I'm going to give you the data from here. Here should also be some localization into that particular area. My data should also be localized. But when we develop encoder decoder based system, I'm not saying that. That's why anything could be possible. But it would be better represented. Say that no, make this data, for example, somewhere here. One thing, number one, this is called regularization. If we apply any kind of thing on the hidden space, that you should be of this particular kind to satisfy some of my requirements, then it is called what? Regularization. I am telling that the hidden representation should also, along with this reconstruction loss, that actually we have not given the word. This word, this should be equal to this thing. It is called a reconstruction loss. This should be smaller. Regularization loss also, that says that this thing should be into some specific format. One more thing, I think you can answer better. That if I ask you that, let's assume that here the data was, I'm just making something, okay. Let's assume that distribution, this was the data distribution. And if here the data distribution becomes this, would you like this distribution? Would you like that it should be into this way? And now you can see that here also the data was here localized, here also the things are localized, but now they are not into the same shape. Would you like that? Maybe, I don't know that. It looks like similar, okay. By chance, I have made the thing that I always say that I am bad in driving. Okay, let me make this thing. Okay, let me make like this. Would you like this? No problem. At least he has solved this particular problem that the things are not scattered. But maybe I don't like this. Why this also could not be something related to this thing? Same kind of structure is also there, then it is even better representation. So I also, in this particular domain also, I want that the representation should be something very similar. I want to reduce the mutual information between them. I want to increase the mutual information between. How can I represent this mutual information? Once again, it is a distribution. This is another distribution. Two distribution, we can apply some other thing. For example, KL divergence or anything, KL divergence, JS divergence, or any other method that can find out the similarity between two distributions. We can apply and we can say that reduce this particular value also. Make sense? So this, by this way, we can do some kind of monitoring, and we can tell that make these things better for me. There is another name called the sparse auto encoder. If you get the idea, if you are good with this particular idea that we have just discussed, so there is something called a sparse auto encoder that tells that whenever you come up with this with the feature representation, this value should be sparse. Sparse means what? Okay. So, for example, if you want to use it for the classification, in the classification, what happens? There are C number of classes. C maybe, for example, 5. So 5 values would be there. Okay. 5 values would be there. So item is going to be of one class only. Now 1000, this kind of thing. Actually, when we are inputting the things, item is of this particular kind. It may be possible two places also, something, those things, settings are also possible, but for the sake of simplicity, let me say that only one place there would be one, other place it would be zero. If this representation is this 0.4, 0.32, 0.1512, it is not good. It would be better that the representation, the hidden representation that comes to me should be of this particular kind, 0.99000.001. If I want to utilize this particular hidden representation for the classification, my hidden representation should be sparse, means one value should be high, other value should be lesser. So how can I do that? All right, in the function, in the last function that we had a few minutes back, I can add one more term. So this term you recognize, okay? Reconstruction loss. Everybody, reconstruction loss. And this is another thing that measure, that measures that how sparse the output is. If I add this particular thing, that the learned feature vector are going to be very useful for the classification. Make sense? Denoising autoencoder. And this is a kind of cheating. Let me tell you what happens. You have an encoder-decoder network. Here is a hidden representation. Here is a decoder. And here, let's assume that this was the image. I'm telling that I will not show you this image. I will show you something different version of this. Means take the image, do some kind of bad thing with the image. Apparently, this is a poor guy. He is going to produce something. Okay, he is going to produce something. And at the last, you say that I'm going to find out the last between X and X bar. So this poor, they are forced to reduce the difference between these two things. Okay. So this image is going to be, if this image is going to be equal to this image, so this image is going to be good image. Provide. Introduce some kind of problems. All right, what is the use? Some image, just feed it here, you'll be getting good image. Make sense? So denoising autoencoder, where the input is actually not x, where input is not x instead of some corrupted copy of randomized item, and you see the loss between x and this, because if you do this, your network is going to learn how to be denoise and how to correct these problems. Make sense? Yeah.
The vision only input noise till the extent that the distribution is somewhat retained. That hyperspace. It will create outlier which put a lot of noise.
Look, when we were discussing about the distribution of the data, we were concerned that whether this is an image or not. Extreme example could be you shuffle all the pixels. It is also with the same histogram, things are not represented into any way. It is a possible image, but it is not the image. So if I say that it is an image, it is possible for me, because other things would be very extreme. Whatever kind of noise you are introducing, by which whatever you are going to get, you can tell that, yeah, its image is bad image. Point is this, bad image is also image. But there could be something that you can come up that is even not image. And the possibility that who are not image, they are large, very large. Because if you have an image of 10 plus 10, there are 10,000 permutations possible. Am I right? If an image is of 100 plus 100, how many ways I can permute? 10,000 permutations. And none of them would be, I think most of them are not going to make any sense. Few of them are going to make sense because 2 pixels swapping, 3 pixel swapping may be making sense. But most of them are not going to make sense. So when I'm going to introduce the noise, known area only. So it is not going to disturb the distribution as such.
This can also be used for deep learning, right? Deep learning and image.
Yes, I'm telling you, this is the deep learning. All these things are deep learning. Okay. Blurring. Okay. Blurring. Okay. Okay. So you blurred image can be deblurred. That's it. Yeah. Okay. Achha, give me the idea that if you have a blurred image, how can you deblur it?
According to this architecture,
this architecture, don't talk about general, tell me. Deblurring means you are introducing some small portions there. Low frequency component you should cut. Apply a low filter and find out the difference. And you subtract from that. They subtract the difference from that. Have you seen that foggy image, defogging? Just see this kind of thing, very small kernel. You take the foggy image, apply some kind of averaging kernel on that, see the difference, and that difference you subtract from the original image. Immediately you will get very good image. All right, so this also you can be done by this, okay? Denoising autoencoder. Third thing, contractive autoencoder. Okay, so sometimes the idea is this, that that when you have an encoder decoder network, you are going to provide X and you get the hidden representation, and here you get X bar. So if you feed X plus delta, means a small change into the X. So this representation could be very high, very large. This can be any other representation. Okay. It may not be the same thing. It may not be, it could be something different. But the reconstruction is actually smaller. Do some changes over here. Only small changes here also should happen. Anna? Few minutes back, that it should not change much. So here in this equation, something has been added that is telling that if you find out the derivative of this particular hidden representation with respect to the X, for all the input images that you have, this added into your learning function, in your loss function. So what would happen? That this is going to force that whatever similar hidden representation into the hidden dimension, nearby areas only, if you are going to change something into the input, they would also come into the need. Make sense? So this is called a contractive autoencoder. Okay. So we have seen that with the X and with the X bar, I can say that there is some mutual information. Mutual information could be that what is the distribution of this particular thing? Distribution of hidden representation. What is the distribution of hidden representation? You say that some KL divergence I am going to apply, and this value should also be minimized. If you can apply something like this, this is called the mutual information I'm going to increase between the input and output. Sometimes you also want that, and this is an important thing, okay, that there are some distribution into the input, and the same kind of distribution I also want into the hidden representation. Sometimes you want that here I don't know that what is the representation. So is it possible that place? What I want to say, I want to say that sometime you want that it should be something, it should be centered around something. However, distribution is similar, but this should be as compact as possible. You want a compact representation. Also, sometimes you want to be compact. Why? Because if you want to feed dog image, cat image, everything, and they are going to have into the different representation, different places they are going to be represented. Cat images is here, dog images is here, elephant images are here, different. They can overlap. Sometimes you want that this should be very as small as possible. This representation should be as small, as centered as possible. Right? So if centered representation is there, representation would be better. How can you bring that particular part? You say that I have a Gaussian distribution with the mu is equal to 0 and sigma is equal to 1, and hidden representation of this hidden should be minimized with respect to that. Along with this formula, I add this particular one more formula. Try to understand what is this. I am telling that I want to reduce the between the Gaussian distribution and the hidden space representation. By this, what would happen? It would try to attain the property of Gaussian distribution. So it would be centered around something. So now, earlier you were thinking that elephant distribution is here to here. You are thinking that it is here at this particular point, because when there is a Gaussian distribution, at the mean, it is very much, its intensity is a maximum at the mean. So it would be there only. And things would be smaller. You can add one more term. So one term, second term, and few more terms we have just seen that you can apply and requirement. So we have discussed this, that into the general thing, we can treat it as a feature extractor. And our thing is this, that whatever input you are going to provide, encoder is going to give you the feature. After training, when you do the training, after that you can remove this as a feature extractor, and then you can develop based on this, you can get the classification. Initially you train both the part, and after encoder part you put a fully connected network classification head, and using that you can find out that further. You can do the regression. This is the feature. Where is the item? There could be a matcher also. Find out the similarity between the two things. As in the last class, we have seen that two Siamese network where two different, the same architecture also. And then you apply the fully connected over here and find out that what is the similarity between these two things. Two images, image one and image two are fed over here. Same circuit here and here are going to be fed. It is Siamese network. Then you deploy a fully connected architecture. Find out that what is the score, the matcher. Sometime you can apply this thing. This gives you the important feature. Then you combine this thing and find out that what is the segmentation, means what is the area where that particular thing is this, a particular thing is there. For example, if you have developed a system that can highlight that where is a chair, so you can use this feed into some, it can, on this particular image, it can draw boxes. That here is a chair, here is an item, like that. So this is the important thing, that end-to-end training could be done on extracted features. After the getting the feature, you can do the end-to-end training. Train a classifier, regressor, matching module, segmentation, etc. to find out anything. And then you can shift focus to the feature. Okay, you can think about other things. Some examples to motivate you. So here is an example that I must have included the difference. Here one input has been, one image has been inputted, then the feature has been obtained using this feature, and there is a direct connection also. That previous thing goes here. It is a UNET kind of architecture, and then on the same image, it applies the steps that it has obtained over here and come up with this kind of output. What it tells? Segmentation. Segmentation means where are the different component, what are the different components, and where they are. Here is a road. Here is a tree. Here is a trees. Here is a sky. Here is a building. So it can come up these kind of things. Here is another car. So it is a unit architecture. Make sense? Another interesting example. I have taken this from the course material of Yuan Li Kun. You can just see this. Here is a link. You can find out on my slides. So what is the idea? Idea is this, that you know that MNIST data images are 28 cross 28. So 784 values are there. This is the image, okay? Here is a 9 written, 8 written, something written like that. So the same and the same image need to be output. So based on that, it has actually done some kind of improvements. And when he understood the things, what was there, that the hidden representation that we are going to get was only having the 30 cells. So by this, what do I mean? That this complete data, I can represent to the 30 value. So it is reduced to the 30 dimensional value. And on the data, PCA has also been applied. So because this complete data was there, on this I can apply PCA to get 30 values, and then I can reconstruct on the PCA and get the same thing. Two things are shown over here. You can see that this, you can see that this is a 2. Here is some problem. You can see that in this deep learning autoencoder one, it is not like there. Here you can see that everywhere, if you compare this original image and this image, you can see that with the PCA, there is only problem has been introduced. But when you learn using autoencoder, you can see that somewhere there is even better. So you can see that here it is better, here it is better. Looks like that somewhere it is the better representation. With only 30 values, need not to use all the values. This generator provide this 30 value, you can get this thing. What is the architecture? The architecture is this, that 784 is transformed first to 250, then 30, and the same thing into the reverse order. And you can see that very good thing has been obtained. Another motivating example that actually uses the comparison between two documents. I want to compare that how two documents are similar or not. So there is document one, document two, document three. My objective would be to come up with a feature. What is the feature of this particular document? Make sense? So how can I find out the feature? I don't know. The very biggest problem is this, that most of the time we use bag of word kind of model that tells that what are the words. So from this thing, I'm going to make a dictionary kind of bag of word everybody knows. So it is a vector where every location is actually corresponding to, for example, elephant, cat, car. So in this document, if there is elephant, particular vector, and this vector would be used to represent this document. In this paper, they have used the 2000 size this vector, and then they have developed a 500 neurons, then 250 neurons, then 10 neurons, then 250 again, 1000, and then try to reduce the difference between the two vector representation that are going to come over here. Once again, when I got this particular representation, I'm going to apply a softmax on this so that summation of all these values becomes one. That I'm going to feed here, and I'm going to get output of this thing. And I'm interested in this 10 words, which are going to be my new representation of this particular data. Understand? Yeah.
Sir, if I'm inputting only the bag of words, then won't I lose?
You would lose. Forget about that. You would lose all these things. There's no other way. You would lose all these things. But focus on this particular thing. I'm going to get 10 words to represent my data, and I'm going to find out the similarity. So linear semantic analysis, etc., kind of other methods, their accuracy was lesser, such as 30%, even this autoencoder. And when the 10 dimensional data that we got, if we reduce it to the apply PC and reduce to the two dimensional space and try to see that how it is represented. So 10 values, apply PC, find out two values and put into the two dimensional space. Okay. So when we apply linear semantic analysis, etc. So this is what we get. Let me tell you what it is. This green is a document. So these are the documents. Okay. So another kind of document are red, purple. Okay. All these things are different kind of documents. You can see that green is here also, green is here also, green is here also. This kind of. But this is how earlier methods we are using. But auto encoder to find out that how the what is the thing, and then you come up with the two distinctive value. The document is like this. Because of the non-linearity, you can see that all the green are here, purples are here, red are here, green are here, blacks are here, different kind of databases you can segregate. So it finds out the better representation because of the non-linearity. Thank you very much. Thank you for joining me.